Hey everyone, it's actually Jeb Bush, and we are back with another Underdog NBA best ball draft. Just like in our last video, which if you haven't seen will be in the description below, we are going to be drafting a roster for the Double Dribble Contest. Now, if you're unfamiliar with the Double Dribble Contest or NBA best ball in general, I highly recommend you go check out that first video I did to get just a quick rundown of what you can expect in this video. However, unlike that last video, we're gonna try and keep this one a little bit shorter and more concise. Now, before we get started, if you don't have an account on Underdog, go ahead and check out the link in the description below and use promo code ActuallyJebBush. For a limited time, Underdog is matching your first deposit up to $1,000, which will give you enough money to almost max the Double Dribble Contest. Also, as always, make sure to like the video, make sure to subscribe to the channel, like the video, and leave a comment below letting me know what you think. And without further ado, let's go ahead and jump right into this draft. So for this draft, it looks like we got the two spot. And for me, this is an easy Wimby click. Now, I've heard some pretty compelling arguments from people as to why you should stick Giannis ahead of Wimby at the two spot. And if you're only planning to do a small amount of drafts, I think that's a pretty viable strategy. But if you're doing drafts at a little higher volume, I think you have to take Wimby at two because you are almost never getting him at the three spot. And at least for me, I definitely want some exposure to Wimby, just like I want some exposure to Jokic as well. Looks like we're not even making it out of the first round before someone in this draft is taking a somewhat unorthodox pick. As you can see, Bosnian Dude grabs Anthony Edwards at the 8 spot with Joel Embiid still available. If you follow me on Twitter or have seen some of my content, you know that I am not a Joel Embiid fan. And in the Double Dribble, I pretty much avoid taking him unless I have to. However, I think at the 8 spot, you kind of almost have to take him because the value is just too good. It also allows you to build a somewhat unique Embiid lineup with maybe a combination of the 1, 2, and 3 pick that you aren't typically going to get with Embiid. So even though I have Embiid ranked lower than most, I still would take him here. Now, I do think the case against Embiid in best ball is pretty strong this year. He's already an injury-prone big man who can't stay in shape and puts a lot of pressure on his knees. He's constantly flopping and falling down, which just increases his potential of an injury. And on top of that, now that he's gotten his token MVP, I think he's starting to realize that all that should matter is the playoffs. And I think he's going to make an extra effort to be healthy going into the playoffs. And that might mean playing less minutes, sitting more games, load managing, maybe sitting out on an injury that he would usually play through. I just personally think this year the risk is much greater than the reward. So with our second pick, we definitely won't be taking a center since we picked Wimby as our first pick. So that really leaves us with a decision between Booker and Donovan Mitchell. And as you can see by my rankings, I have Booker above Mitchell. And so far, I really haven't been clicking on Mitchell's name that much at all. While Donovan Mitchell is a bona fide superstar and will put up pretty impressive numbers on the Cleveland Cavaliers throughout the season, I have more or less faded him so far. I've done over 20 drafts so far, and I've only clicked his name once. And that's just because I think players like Booker are in a better situation to thrive than Mitchell. Mitchell's on a team with three other All-Stars who all want the ball in their hands. On top of that, so far, the four of them haven't played very well together. Last season, the best stretch of games that Donovan Mitchell played was when two of those guys were injured, including Darius Garland. While I do love Darius Garland and Donovan Mitchell for different reasons, I just don't think they make a very cohesive backcourt. I think they step on each other's toes a lot, and both of them are trying to get into their own flow, and it might interrupt the other one. Now, you might say to me, Jeb, couldn't you make the exact same argument for Devin Booker? And I think that's a very fair point, because last season, the Suns weren't cohesive either. However, during the offseason, the Suns hired a new head coach, and they picked up Tyus Jones to play starting point guard. This will allow Devin Booker to play this season as a true shooting guard, which is a role he has excelled in the past. On top of that, Kevin Durant and Bradley Beal are getting older, and Devin Booker is coming off a really good Olympics performance where you had coaches and teammates saying that he was the real MVP of the team. While I don't think Devin Booker has a real chance at winning MVP this season, I think he's going to make a real push. So unless something changes, I'm taking Booker over Mitchell pretty much every time. Now for our third pick, while I'm tempted to click on Jalen Johnson here to get our first wing, we're clicking on Lauri Markkanen. He's a proven all-star who can put up big empty stats on a bad Utah Jazz team. Now there is a valid concern that he might get benched if the Jazz start winning too much, so I'm not going overboard with my Markkanen exposure, but I'm making sure that I have a decent amount. Since I got a center instead of a wing as my first pick, I really want to try to make sure I have three wings by the fifth round, which means I need to grab back-to-back wings here. Now this season, wings seem to be a pretty scarce resource. And as you can see, before our fourth pick, there's a bit of a run on wings. So while my first pick here probably would have been Franz Wagner, we're going to go ahead and click on Kyle Kuzma. Similar to Markkanen, I think he's a big stats on a bad team type of guy, and there's a possibility that he could get traded as well. Thankfully, it looks like Ideas doesn't have the same plan as us. He just grabbed Giddy and Brandon Miller, which means I'm going to be clicking on Jimmy Butler. So far, Jimmy Butler is the wing that I am the most overweight on in best ball and find myself reaching for more often than not. Look, we talked about it before. Jimmy Butler had a disappointing end to his season last year. So much so that Pat Riley even made a comment about it.
If you're not on the court playing against Boston or on the court playing against the New York Knicks, you should keep your mouth shut.
On top of that, the Heat did not give Jimmy Butler the extension that he definitely thought he deserved. So he's coming into this season pissed, properly motivated, and with a chip on his shoulder. And historically speaking, that's the Jimmy Butler I want. Now there's definitely some valid concerns regarding his injury history, as well as his age and how it might affect his ability to consistently perform at a high level. But this is where I'm planting my flag. I'm taking as much Jimmy Butler as I can get right now. Now we're coming up to the 6th and 7th picks, and I definitely need to make sure that I grab a guard in one of those two picks. So I'm going to make sure I grab Vassell here. I think he's set up to have a really good season, and on top of that, we have Wimby. Wimby just makes everyone on his team better, and if Wimby's playing well, I think Vassell will follow suit. While I don't think stacking is nearly as important in NBA best ball as it is in NFL best ball, I think in this case, this is kind of a neat little stack to have. Now, I'm going to queue up Vassell here, but because I'm seeing a bit of another run on wings, I think I'm going to reach and grab one. And unfortunately, it looks like I'm going to take OG Anunoby a little higher than ADP, which is not ideal and not a player that I'm really wanting to reach for. But I already have a pretty decent amount of Keegan Murray, and I just worry about clicking on him considering DeMar DeRozan's getting added, who has a lot of volume and usage that comes along with it. So we're clicking on OG more to just diversify the exposure a bit. But I'm pretty confident that Vassell will be there for my 7th round pick, so that's why I feel comfortable reaching for OG so much in this case. And there we go. We'll grab Vassell as well. Now for rounds 9 and 10, not only do we not need a wing here, but the wings I'm seeing are just not players that I'm particularly excited about considering who I already have. Now you could argue John Collins is a good stats, bad team type of guy, but every team that he's ever been on, they immediately put him on the trading block, seems to always be having problems, he has injury issues. I don't know, maybe this is a hole in my strategy, but I think John Collins is just so unreliable that he is an absolute waste of a click here. Now, I love PJ Washington as a player, but I am a little nervous of what his role is going to look like this season with Klay Thompson getting added. It just reminds me of a very infamous interview that Klay Thompson did once KD had joined the Warriors. A reporter asked him who would be sacrificing touches and shots for KD, kind of implying that Klay Thompson would, considering, you know, you can't take away shots from Curry, the greatest shooter of all time. And Klay Thompson just so coolly and nonchalantly said, I'm going to be getting my shots.
Klay Thompson speaking with The Vertical on the addition of Kevin Durant to his team. Quote, I feel kind of disrespected that people keep using the term sacrifice to describe me and describe us. But I'm not sacrificing bleep because my game is not changing. I'm still going to try to get buckets, hit shots, come off screens. I want to win and have a fun time every game. We play.
Now, I know this Klay is a little different, a little older, maybe a little more mature, maybe a little more willing to buy into the team aspect. But at the end of the day, the Mavs got him for that PJ Washington role, hoping he would be a better shooter and therefore an upgrade. So like I said, we need a guard here anyways, so we're going to click on Tyler Hero. The Heat and Eric Spoelstra have been promising us for years that Tyler Hero would take this incredible leap. And although we haven't seen it, maybe this is the year. And at this point, I'm looking for ceiling potential, so I'm grabbing Tyler Hero. Now, with a somewhat similar thought process, we're going to go ahead and grab Brandon Pajemski. Look, Steve Kerr and the Warriors said he's going to be taking 10 threes a game. It sounds like they want him to be the next Jordan Poole before he got punched in the face.
Whaley has landed several of those inside low kicks.
And with Klay gone, there's a lot more threes available than last year. So let's roll the dice on another ceiling potential here. All right, so we got a 4-4-1 build here going into the 11th and 12th round. So that means we're probably going to want to grab a wing and a guard, make it a 5-5-1. And the reason I'm so comfortable here not grabbing another center, even though we're at the 12th round and I only have one, is the fact that my center is Wimby. Look, if Wimby gets injured, this lineup is toast anyway. Wimby has to perform for this to be good, so we're going to depend on him at the center spot. With only three wings available here, I think I'm going to take one at my 11th pick because there are quite a few guards I like here, so I'm kind of happy whoever I get in the 12th round. I like Klay. I don't hate Westbrook. I really like Malik Monk. I like Sharp. I think there's a lot of options here. So let's go ahead and grab Herb Jones. While I do love Cam Johnson, I am a little nervous with the whole situation with the Nets. You know, do they go ahead and bench him because they're winning too much? You know, they're really trying to tank and get Cooper Flagg. Or do they trade him to another team where he gets regulated to a more specialized role? Or it could be the opposite. You know, he gets traded to a team and he excels and starts putting up massive numbers. But there's just too many unknowns with Cam Johnson. So for the most part, I'm kind of fading him at this point. With Herb Jones, I think there's a lot of potential no matter what happens with the Pelicans. Ideally, Brandon Ingram gets traded and Herb Jones gets more of that minutes and usage. But regardless, he's a defensive monster and can hit threes. So the Pelicans will definitely carve out minutes for him. And he's a player that can score fantasy points on both sides of the ball, which is always a plus for me. Since Malik Monk was taken, I'm tempted to click Klay or tempted to click Bogdan. I think both have really interesting use cases here, but I think we're going to go with Sharp. Now, I've been clicking Sharp a lot, so maybe I need to mix up my rankings a bit and diversify my exposure, but I just really like Sharp. I think he's a really fun click. I think he is going to get plenty of minutes and usage on Portland. I think he's going to have a green light to do essentially whatever he wants, especially if the Trailblazers go ahead and trade Simons. So I just think there's a lot of upside with a lot of potential for quite a few ceiling games with Sharp. So yeah, I might be a little overweight on him, but like I said, a really fun click, especially if he stays healthy this season. All right, so we're reaching the point where we need another center. And really the only two options here are Jakob Poeltl or Draymond Green. I will not be clicking Draymond Green. I'm fading him super hard. He said on his own podcast that him and Steve Kerr both agree that he is one of the worst players when it comes to meaningless basketball.
I couldn't get myself going. Like, I couldn't get up for a game. Like, I could get up for a big game. Like, but if we're going to suck like this every year, my window is closed because I can't get up for these meaningless games. I mean, Coach Kerr has told me one day, he said when he pulled me to the side a few years back. It's when we were competing for a championship. And I'm like out there just going through the motions. He pulled me to the side. He said, you have to be the worst meaningless basketball game player I've ever seen in my life.
And I think the Warriors will be playing a lot of meaningless basketball this season and will be much closer to being a lottery team as opposed to even a play-in team. Now, they could make a huge trade this season and suddenly Draymond doesn't have to play meaningless basketball. But considering all of his antics, his aging, and his pretty noticeable skill drop-off, I'm just not clicking Draymond Green under any circumstance. So that means we're grabbing Jakob Poeltl. I think Jakob Poeltl is a really great floor play. I think he can put up some very solid numbers consistently, whether he's on the Raptors or if he gets traded to someone like the Warriors. And then with our next pick, I can't resist clicking on Tyus Jones. Now, I really loved clicking on Tyus Jones before he signed with the Suns, and he was my last pick in a bunch of drafts. but I still feel very comfortable taking him at his new ADP in the 12th or 13th round. I think Tyus Jones will really excel in his new role, being surrounded by elite scorers. I think he'll get plenty of easy layups, plenty of easy open threes, and lots of assists. He's a player who doesn't turn over the ball, makes smart basketball decisions, and not only will that get him plenty of minutes and build trust with his teammates and coaches, but it'll avoid him from losing dumb fantasy points because of silly boneheaded plays. All right, we have three picks left, and while I could get away with having two centers, I think I'm going to go ahead and grab a third one and kind of take a bit of a dart throw here. Now, if you've been following this channel for a long time, you know that there are a couple players that we have absolutely loved, and Okongwu is one of those. I think the short list is really Tyus Jones, Daniel Gafford, and Okongwu. And while Gafford has kind of been introduced now to the more mainstream casual NBA fans, considering he's on a team with Luka and he had a big impact during their finals run, Okongwu, I think, is on the opposite side of the spectrum there. I feel like a lot of people still don't know about him and his just raw, incredible athleticism. And unfortunately, no one will know about him until the Hawks decide to trade Capella. And for years now, we have speculated that Capella will get traded, and it's almost happened allegedly, but it never has. But maybe this is the year. Maybe this is the year that Capella gets out of the way and Okongwu gets to unleash his incredible athleticism and energy with putback dunks, rebounds, blocks, racking up fantasy points, putting up some potential awesome ceiling games. Now, I know that's a big if, it's a lot of speculation, but we're on round 14, so we're taking a dart throw here. And like I said, if you've known this channel, we felt that way about Tyus Jones, Okongwu, and Gafford for years. So I think this year is definitely Tyus Jones' like coming out party to the casual fan. I think he's going to be more of a household name. And I am praying that Clint Capella gets traded and Okongwu finally gets a little bit of that spotlight as well. After that, we're going to go ahead and grab a sixth wing here in Khalil Ware. Khalil Ware is actually a center, but for some reason he's labeled a wing. So it's kind of a little bit of a cheat code considering, you know, wings are pretty scarce. So getting an extra wing who is, you know, would usually be labeled a center is definitely a W here. Now, at this point in the draft, like we said with Okongwu, this is a dart throw. But unlike some other rookies, I think Khalil Ware will actually be given the opportunity to succeed. Whether he does or not is kind of the million-dollar question. But the Heat will definitely put him in positions to perform, to get real minutes out there, to put up real fantasy scores. And, you know, there's a good chance that his scores never really factor into our best ball lineup. But like I said, he's a dart throw, and I think he's a really interesting player to grab. All right, and now for our final pick here. More often than not, I'm grabbing Christian Brown, but I really like my guard situation, and I think I would like to add one more wing. So I think I'm going to go ahead and just take a dart throw here with Terrence Shannon. Now, I am slightly biased here because I did see Terrence Shannon absolutely dominate at Summer League. I mean, in the game he played, he looked unstoppable. He was incredible. He was definitely the best player on the floor. However, the problem is Terrence Shannon is on the Timberwolves, who are a deep team looking to make a possible NBA Finals run. So realistically, I just don't know how much play he's actually going to get unless there are some significant injuries on the Wolves. However, with that being said, since we don't have any Wolves on our team, I think this is a really good dart throw. Because if key players on the Timberwolves do get injured, they're not in our lineup. So we're only experiencing the upside if Shannon gets to play. But once again, like I said, this one's a pretty out there dart throw, and I really don't expect him to be contributing to this lineup much. And I think that about does it. I actually really, really like this lineup. I think partly because I don't have too many Wemby teams, so it's always fun to be able to click him as my first pick. But I really, really like a lot of the guys we grabbed. But with that being said, what do you think? Let me know in the comments below. Did I mess up this draft? Were there players that I missed? Are there players I'm overvaluing? Are there players I'm undervaluing? Let me know and let me know why. I would be very interested to hear I love talking about NBA basketball and all the strategy behind it. That's why I started making videos on it. But yeah, with that being said, if you made it this far, thank you so much for watching. Please make sure to subscribe to the channel and like the video, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Please clap.